Happy Tisha B'Av, the day of doom, the day of catastrophe, the day of disaster. The Jewish holiday commemorating this falls on August 5th, and here we are today. It certainly is a day of doom and disaster for me, but also it can be a day of breakthrough, you see. And it's also that. It's kind of right now, it's both. We can talk today about, in this video, about nirvana, moksha in Hindu, liberation, salvation, self-realization is all the same. And I've always wanted to simplify the entire situation. All this nitpicking, you know, is not where it's at. So let's see if we can do that. And certainly we can. We certainly can. The fact is, there's only nirvana. People say, well, you know, what's the difference between the samsara and nirvana? There is no samsara. There is no samsara. So the question, what's the difference, is itself the problem. I've often seen that in this world, that the questions are the problem. They're hiding premises. They're hiding premises. It's a way we state premises and pretend to be wanting to solve something. It's a way of delay. It's a way of holding on. It's expression of our continuity fear. Remember, I don't have a world problem. I don't have a samsara problem. I have a continuity problem. A samsara problem has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. It's the questions we use that are the problem. Like, what is the difference between samsara and nirvana? What's the premise? The premise is that there are two different states, two different places, so to speak. And that's a false premise. There is no samsara. The realization is of nirvana is that there's only nirvana. There's never been samsara. There's never been samsara. It doesn't exist. So, of course, we can... it's funny because we're searching for the answer. That search is for an answer itself is what the searching means. You're looking for some place where you're not. Like a path means you're going from some place to somewhere else. You've left one place and you're going to somewhere else. In reality is all one. Pure spaciousness everywhere. There is no other place. You can't leave pure spaciousness and go somewhere else. It's impossible. You can't even take one step away from pure spaciousness. You can't even take one step. Wherever you are, all is. The allness of pure spaciousness is. So you cannot have a path. It's impossible to have a path. And if there is no path, how can you have samsara? You can't go anywhere where you are not. You can't go anywhere where you're not. There's no samsara. There's only nirvana. There's only... You all is in pure spaciousness. Always. There's no way to leave it whatsoever. So how could there be samsara? There's only a desire for samsara, a search for it, as it were. But where are we searching? Really, again, there's not even a search for it, because you can't, there's nowhere to look that isn't nirvana. But it's the desire for it that is the only issue, and ultimately it's the continuity problem. We've been hoping, desiring, trying to quote-unquote, find samsara. It's kind of like we're trying to find some place that that's outside of pure spaciousness. But there isn't any such place. So we've never even taken one step towards succeeding at all. So nothing's ever left. No search has ever begun. No path has ever started. Or just entertain the idea of form appearances and the differences of appearances, and trying to judge as if it means there's a potential for a search. The most we can say is we're desiring a potential for samsara, a potential for a path, a potential, but there's not even that. So the real realization is there is no samsara. It's not how did I awaken from samsara, there isn't any. It's the same as saying, how did you escape from the pit? There isn't any pit. Or how did you get rid of that snake that's actually a rope? Didn't get rid of the snake. Samsara is like you see a rope and you think it's a snake. And you're in samsara, misidentification of where you are. Trying to deny where you are. But denying where you are, does that change where you are in any way? If we say, I'm going to deny that I'm in pure spaciousness, does that have any effect at all? None. No effect whatsoever. Then how can there be samsara, actually? I cannot. So, again, how do we escape from the pit, that there is no pit? We didn't escape from it. How do we get rid of that snake? That we didn't get rid of any snake. It was never there. We just realized, oh, it's never been there. Samsara, we just realized, oh, it's never been here. There is no samsara. We just take all this motion of form to mean that there's change happening. Why? Everything change in what? Change in where we are? Or something is? There's no change taking place in anything where it is. See, our desire is to be somewhere else other than reality so we can pretend to be greater than God. There is nowhere else. But when we're seeing all this motion of form, we see, well, this form is changing its position relative to some other form. Okay. It's called duality, relativism. But it's not changing its whereabouts in relation to pure spaciousness at all, ever. Nothing is. So all this juxtaposition and play, dance of form is not changing the position of where anything is at all. Nothing's changing position in relationship to its being, ground of being, at all. Zero. Zero change. No change has ever happened. So the problem with saying of samsara is we think it's some condition to get out of or something like that. And then it seems conceptual and form-based in it, but we're not even in the condition. We've never been in the condition, actually. Nothing's ever been in a samsaric condition, actually. Not actually. And people can play with this, you know, a lot, and they have, and they wasted a lot of time. But it's better for the standpoint of realization to say there is no samsara. There is none. There is none. Never been. There has never been. See, we're interested in awakening, not on constructing some sort of academic theological wordplay. So what is the way of realization? It's there's never been any samsara. There's never been any dream. I've never been asleep like that.
Hi.
So there's a difference between actual effective practice and discussion. There's a big difference. Big difference. In order to discuss, you have to have something to discuss, right? So you got two sides. Here in practice, they're not two sides to it. We're not two-sided here. There's no more two-sidedness. We're saying that there's never been any samsara. We've never been asleep. We've never been dreaming. None of that's ever happened, actually. So practice is always this one-sidedness. It's always this one-sidedness. And this brings us to the full stop of recognizing what? Where we are. Where are we? Really? We've had a desire to be somewhere else, a whim, but nothing's ever happened. Not even our thoughts have left where they are. Everything is one with the ground of being. Everything has always been one with the ground of being. Nothing's ever happened. So in practice, there has to be this one-sidedness, so to speak, this oneness. Cannot have two-sidedness. There's no practice there. There's only waste of time and discussion. And it's a very different feeling. When you get this one-sidedness, you get this feeling like, wow. Impactful, very impactful in some way, yeah. It's like people sitting around with hot peppers discussing what to call them. Now, this, what kind of pepper you got there? Well, this is Moruga. This is the Moruga. Moruga, really? Moruga? Huh. I thought it was a scorpion. Well, sometimes they call it a scorpion. Someone else says, no, it's a Trinidad. Is it Trinidad? Really, it's a Trinidad? What do you think it's called? Well, we could call it Trinidad Scorpion or Trinidad Moruga Scorpion. Or, well, I don't know. I think I call it a Trinidad. Well, why do you call it a Trinidad? Well, you know, and they spend the whole day talking about the peppers. Someone else eats the pepper. Okay, now, it's a very different experience, isn't it? Very different experience. Someone's getting the burn. It's like, so they know they're experiencing the burn, as it were. You can only experience the burn when you get this one-sidedness, really. It's not even a side. Oneness is just, there's no samsara. All is nirvana. All is nirvana. We're just simply refusing to admit that, is all. The refusal to admit where we are can seem to take all sorts of form, but that's totally irrelevant. Totally irrelevant. There is no form to where we're not at all, actually. What happens is the mind plays with relativity of form, like, well, relative to this other form, this form appears different. But there is no form of not being here, not being where we are. There is no form at all. These are just, they're just symbols. The most you can say is we're just playing with symbols, and even those symbols are, all symbols is a symbol. The symbol is in pure spaciousness, perfectly, all is. All is in pure spaciousness. So, intellectual discussion has to give way towards one-sided declarations. There is no samsara at all. There is none. There's never been samsara. what this does is it really crushes the conceptual structure of symbolization and delay. Now it has to be done. It has to be done. And it doesn't matter particularly, you know, how it's done. But it has to be done. It has to be this end of the road, one-sided. There is no road. There is no end of the path. There's never been a path. You can't arrive to where you are. You cannot arrive. There is no arrival. There is no arrival. And so these statements are like blocking duality. Just duality just runs into this barrier. And then from there, you feel this kind of aching sensation, sort of a deep aching sensation, a reverberation, sometimes a reverberation, aching sensation. Now, this morning I realized everyone has the exact same problem, as it were, is in the exact same situation. Everyone. With the exact same remedy. Exact same remedy. And it's only this shift of attention, as it were, off of symbols. Shift of attention off of symbols. And of course, we think the play of thinking, the play of mind, dualistic play of mind, is how we locate ourselves. It's not. It's how we deny where we are, actually. But we're used to thinking that this denial of where we are is some sort of journey to some better place, to where we should be or need to be. It's not. It's not a journey at all. It's not going anywhere. We've never gone anywhere. So we can say, I've never gone anywhere. I have never gone anywhere. And the problem is we have try to identify ourselves with this presumed journey that is supposedly going to lead us to the promised land. And so we say, there is no journey. There's no journey. I've never gone anywhere. Nothing's ever happened. We feel like, oh, I'm a failure. I'm going to fail to reach the promised land. There is no reaching. See, there's no reaching, there's no getting, there's no attaining, there's no arriving. Now this impacts us, hits us at a deep, 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 in a deep way, as it were. Or, to be more even precise, in no way, in no depth at all. It's like a realization of no depth. So it kind of just seems to be everywhere, this feeling of this sort of an aching feeling, like, wow. You might say it's kind of akin to getting rid of a frostbite, or you're thawing out. And they say that freezing isn't painful, it's the thawing out that's painful. And so we're thawing out here, actually. Thawing out. But that's good. I mean, you say that, you know, you have to have this happy warrior attitude where you do have to be a spiritual warrior, actually. No question about it. Because the thawing out seems to give us suffering. But we're happy to suffer in this way. It's great. Can't wait. It's wonderful. As it were, for forever. frozen to awareness of where we really, where all is, in an imaginary, hypothetical, symbolic hope that there's some possibility of some journey at some point, even though we've never begun the journey at all. Or best we can say is we're preparing to take a journey. You could say that. Samsara, you could say, is the preparation to take a, preparing for samsara. It is, you could say, well, we're preparing for samsara, but there isn't any samsara, actually. We're just preparing for it, rehearsing, getting ready for it. It's never here, though. It's never here. So what I'm saying is causing the burn in me for sure. So I can feel how it's really, you know, effective. If you let it go beyond, penetrate through your intellectualism, that has to happen. Now, so what happens when you feel this? Well, you get this ache, sort of ache. Is it pleasant or unpleasant? Is it neither, really? It's, it's just an ache. Like if you work out and your muscles are aching, is that pleasant or unpleasant? Well, it all depends how you, it's half empty, half full kind of situation, actually. So to be the spiritual warrior, you have to say, oh, it's half full, it's half full. Otherwise, you're going to complain and go back to intellectualism and saying, this, you know, there must be a better way. But if you're the spiritual warrior, you say, great, great, this is fine. But don't be a spiritual show-off, because you have to manage this and pay attention and stay with it. Don't try to say, well, I'm going to cause as much ache as possible, you know, just because I want to show off what a great warrior I am. No, that's not a real spiritual warrior. Real spiritual warrior is focused on success and what effectiveness and practical, pragmatic effectiveness. We're not doing this for the sake of doing it. We're doing this for the sake of succeeding here in thawing out, as it were, in accepting that nothing's ever happened. Nothing has ever happened. There's only nirvana. And we say, but how do I reach nirvana? There is no reaching of nirvana. See, dualism always feels inadequate. And it can only say, but how do I get there? How do I get it? There's no getting. There's no reaching nirvana. We're already in nirvana. There's only nirvana. There's nowhere else to be. There's no leaving where we are. Nothing can leave where it is. And the duality just cannot, there's nothing to grasp, so it just burns. Sort of is extinguished, nirvana, without blowing, like as they say, it's extinguished, a flame is extinguished. Blowing also means movement, without movement. motion, so to speak, without blowing. You know, signifies constant motion. The wind always blowing. Without the wind, without the blowing of the wind, nirvana. But really, nothing has been moving anywhere. Everything's moving in relationship to other appearances, but nothing is moving at all in relationship to God, the ground of being, glorious zero dimensionality, pure spaciousness. Nothing is moving closer or farther away from that at all. There's no movement taking place. So you could say stillness and movement, stillness everywhere. Movement does not change that stillness in the slightest bit. Does not change that nirvana in the slightest bit. So nirvana is never changed, is never challenged, is always the case. Nirvana is right now, nirvana is right now. Nirvana always is. Again, we cannot enter into nirvana. There's no entrance to where we already are. And so we might say, well, we're giving up the self. Well, what do you mean by that? Well, the entrance. Again, always this talk is prior to intellectualism. Prior to intellectualism is addressing spirit directly, not thinking or intellectualism. So don't worry about getting answers. Feel the purpose of the question. The questions have a purpose to them. So feel the purpose. Accept the purpose of the question. See, this is very different than intellectualism. Intellectualism is counterpoint. It's examining positions. Okay, this I got my position, your position. What we're saying here is there is no position. There is no position. Nobody has a position. There's only nirvana. We keep thinking we need a position relative to some other position. That's what the I, dualistic I, is form opposed to some other form. And life, meaning the change, apparent change of where you're at compared to where all other form appears to be at. But there is really no such life at all. It's not life at all. There's no life at all. So we imagine that there's some life there in the play of form. There is no life there in the play of form. Never has been. So we imagine we're losing an I, we're losing a self. Losing, no, there's no I, there's no self, there's no life there at all. We're thinking that we have some location and everything else has location, and the shifting and changing all these locations is the play of my life. There's no such play at all. Nothing is changing its location in the slightest bit. Everything is located in the exact same place, the pure spaciousness, the zero dimensionality of God. So we have misidentified life. We've misidentified life. Imagined a false life. and we might say, well, we're dissolving. Dissolving. No. Dissolving the path. No, we're not dissolving anything. There's nothing there to dissolve. There's nothing there. There's nothing to dissolve. You see, I wants to do something, wants to succeed. There's no way to succeed. There's nothing to succeed at. There's nothing to dissolve. Nothing to dissolve, nothing to realize, nothing to stop. Now, meditation, sitting very quietly, can be helpful, but often it's the ego that's meditating. So the ego says, I can be silent, I can be still. That's I can do. See, I can do this. No, there's no meditation. I cannot meditate. I cannot dissolve. I cannot be still. There's nothing to be still. Nothing to still. Nothing needs to be still. So we have to repeatedly get back to the recognition there is no I. Nothing's ever happened. So nothing has to stop happening. Completely one-sided. We cannot make I happy. Cannot make I happy. I will see. Oh, I see. No, there's nothing to see. There's nothing to see. Nothing to get, nothing to see, nothing to attain, nothing to dissolve, nowhere to reach, nowhere to arrive, no attainments at all, no attainments at all. No attainments in the law, even dissolving samsara. No, there's no samsara to dissolve. Whatever I says I can do is not it. See, patterns of motion being given meaning, absolute meaning, are a way to attain something beyond absolute meaning. We have to shift the attention off of that in terms of value. All have equal value or no value. No relative value whatsoever. So it's a different way of looking. It's back to the I was saying about meditation. It can be good to punctuate it with this, you know. No, it's not that. 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 And otherwise, the ego will just say, "I can, you know, I'm gonna sit here and I can do this." I believe effective meditation has to have this burn, the ache, and the silent sitting is you've just been blocked and frustrated in every which way, and you're just burning. But you don't let the burn go to your intellect. You take your medicine. The intellect will, you know, Just leave it out of the picture. The cure is not there. That's just a symptom. The cure is to realize there's nothing to cure. Relativistic intellectual disputes is not a, there's no problem there. There's nothing to cure. That's like saying, is this tree far away or is it close? You see, that's only relative to other form, right? But it's 100% pure spaciousness, abidance, 100% pure spaciousness, abidance. There's no relative term of near or far at all. Everything is that way. So we just have to shift this off this game we're playing, so to speak. Our attention gonna get a slightly different grip. And the intellect says, this isn't fair, I can add something to this. No, the intellect can't add anything to it. The intellect says, I think I can see a way to avoid the burn. No, it cannot. It delays. It sees a way to delay, sure, but not to avoid it. Don't listen to the intellect. Listen to the Holy Spirit. Listen to the voice within that will continually bring up what needs to, what brings this ache, so to speak. Wow. Nothing to dissolve. And don't try to remember, okay, now, don't try to remember, like, notes, okay, now, what did I do before, and how, what are these insights, what am I taking notes? That's the intellect. Don't take notes, because that takes you out of the present burn, you know. But how do I get back here? Well, just stay where you are. Just continually stay where you are. There isn't anywhere else to be. So the idea of you know, form being important is this notion of I. Well, this tree has dimension relative to me, you see. It's got a nearness and a farness relative to this form. But it has no such nearness or farness in terms of its being, of where it is. Where it actually is. And none of that exists at all. So we're trying to impose a dimensionality upon zero dimensionality, is what we're trying to do with form. And there isn't any such imposition. But by saying there's no samsara, there is no imposition. It's just an idle wish at best. You can say samsara is simply an idle wish that has no effect on anything. So there is no samsara. There is no samsara. Only if we take, you know, only if we take this form as representing zero dimensionality, they say, well, oh, that tree's is a distance from where I am. So there's some depth, you see, there's some measurement, there's a path from here to there, there's a difference. There's a judgment. The final judgment is, there's no judgment. Zero dimensionality is not judging any at all. Distance, dimension. So we let go of the idea of self-importance, meaning the importance of where this form is in relationship to any other form. The location of form has no meaning, actually, has no true relevance at all. And that's equally true for all form. But as we look out and everything, we think we see we're like creating a universe, as it were, which doesn't really exist. Because everything seems to have relationship to where the looking is taking place from. But that's an artificial relationship, a made up. That's the play of consciousness. We have to, you know, recognize that is nothing. The play of consciousness is nothing. The tree has a consciousness, is a form. All form has what we would refer to as consciousness, but not really. It's imagined, actually. It's imagined, but consciousness is imagination. It's all being imagined. The tree sees is aware it's there, and then everything else is surrounding the tree, just like I think I'm here, and everything else is the whole universe, you know, surrounds me, right where I am, so to speak. But there is no surrounding in reality. Nothing is surrounded. Because there's no center anywhere. Now we can say, well, I have this ego and I need to, but really we say, no, I don't, there is no ego. There is no ego. See, this is the level of effectiveness. This is effectiveness. There is no ego. There is no ego. There is no ego. See, there is no relativeness, actually. It doesn't exist. It's like ironing out the wrinkles. The garment is seamless, but there seems to be, you know, wrinkles there, and you're ironing them out. The same garment. reach a point where you feel sort of diminishing returns. Okay, that's fine. You can rest a little while, and then more, or you can take a break. That's how it goes. And certainly, to put the pressure on you and say, there is no breakthrough. There is no breakthrough. I keep waiting for a breakthrough. There is no breakthrough. Again, the reason why this is being relevant is I'm accepting these statements without the intellect being involved in it. I'm just accepting the statement, the presence of the statement. There is no breakthrough. There is no breakthrough. And sort of at the level of feeling and emotion or whatever it is, it's like, you know. It's like having this huge tsunami-like effect. Disaster. You know, there is no breakthrough. Wow. Just experience this. The feeling. There is no breakthrough. There is no breakthrough. Who can be in charge of any breakthrough into reality? Right? As soon as we say there's a breakthrough, there's the consciousness. We say somewhere must have a consciousness, an I, right? So it's automatically the I is assumed. But there isn't any breakthrough, then there's no consciousness of a breakthrough, right? There's no I. I refers to consciousness. There's no consciousness in reality. Again, let this slip in beneath your intellect. That's the whole key to it. Let this statement, one-sided statement, there is no consciousness. Let that just have its play, play, so to speak. Let the bell be rung, and then just feel the reverberation. Don't let the bell's rung, and then immediately put your hand on the bell and muffle it and stop it. That's the intellect. What will say, hey, I can help out here. Let me stop that ringing reverberation. Let me grab the bell and stop the reverberation. No, just let the bell keep reverberating, and then you just experience the reverberation of it. That's the way of effectiveness. Don't try to draw conclusions. Just let the play out. Just let the medicine have its effect. Don't look for success or failure. There is no success or failure. There is no success. There is no breakthrough. There is no failure. So you're keeping the thinking and the intellect and the mind out of the whole situation. So you're with you the overall feeling, presence, not emotion, but a feeling or a presence. That's what. You could say, there's nothing I can do. There's nothing I can do. There's another one. Just say, there is nothing I can do. There is nothing that I can do. There is nothing that I can do. True, there's nothing that I can do at all. There is no I. There's nothing that needs to be done. There is no I, and there's nothing that needs to be done. I'll have a break here, so to speak, and maybe do some more later. It's very important that we realize that there's nothing that needs to be done. You know, continue this. Very important right now. So I'll see if I can continue on with this. Okay, that's it.